Welcome to this presentation of the advantage-weighted regression algorithm. First, why am I interested in this algorithm? Let me say first of all that with this presentation I will assume that you have seen my policy search class, which will be pointed to on this slide around here. Okay, so here you have a general picture of policy search and deep reinforcement learning techniques, and I just want to stress that the advantage weighted regression algorithm is quite an outlier with respect to standard techniques, and that's one motivation for studying it. Another motivation is that this algorithm has nice properties. It is partly off policy, as we will see. It is easy to code because it's only based on regression techniques, and it is quite safe with respect to the deadly triad because it does not use any bootstrap technique. Okay, so that's the slide where you need to know more about policy gradient techniques, and that's explained again in my policy search class. So I am assuming, for instance, an agent whose purpose is to collect tennis ball on a tennis court so as to put them aside. Okay, and in the policy search context, in general, you consider that your agent will collect a set of trajectories that will be called tau, and the corresponding rewards R of tau. That's the return of a particular trajectory. And in the standard policy gradient setting, something which is very important is that you consider that you know the distribution of policies that generated these trajectories, and then you write the probability of a trajectory given the policy parameters as the product of the transition function of your MDP times the policy. And more less technically, let's say more intuitively, it means that the probability of the trajectory is the probability of being in the first state and then performing the first action in that state, which is given by your policy, then multiplied by the probability of being in a next state given the state that where you were and the action you took, and again in this new state the probability of taking a new action in that particular state, and so on and so on. So you multiply all the steps, the state probabilities at all states times the probabilities of actions at all states over the whole trajectory. But if you want to compute this probability, you need to know the probability of taking a particular action in a particular state. Okay, and the question is, what if you do not know the distribution over policies? Okay, so if you don't know the distribution of actions defined by your policy P of theta, in that case, what can you do? And answering this question is the essence of the off-policy setting. You will have a replay buffer full of trajectories, and you want to learn something given that you don't know what was the policy that helped generating those trajectories. So first, what can you do? Of course, quite obviously, you can learn a policy from regression. Okay, so this agent would be imitating exactly this one. So the idea is that the learned policy should perform as the observed trajectory. In practice, it means that you take, for instance, a deep neural network, you give it as input the action that the first agent performed, okay, the action that you observe in your replay buffer, and you put this as output and the state as input, and using backpropagation of the gradient, you train your agent to imitate that particular trajectory. So if you provide it with rich enough trajectories, it should be able to generalize to unseen states, so you would obtain a controller that should behave more or less like the observed trajectories that it has in this replay buffer. Okay, so that's a form of learning from demonstration. But the point is that the obtained policy does not perform better than the observed trajectories. The question is, can we do better? And the answer is, yes, we can. That's here. In fact, you could do this, which is better than what we have seen before. Using the previous regression approach, in fact, what we can do is weight the samples with a higher return. We can weight them more heavily if they have a higher return, so we weight the samples based on the return of the trajectory. It means that we imitate a lot the trajectories which gave high return, and we don't imitate a lot the trajectory which gave low return. So that's As we will see later on, this is very similar to policy gradient iteration, but from some off-policy data. And the point is that if you do this, the obtained policy should more imitate the good trajectories than the bad trajectories, so it should perform better than the observed trajectories. The point is to say that if we just perform one iteration of this, this is batch reinforcement learning. We have a replay buffer, we learn just with one iteration a policy with weighting the samples based on the return of the trajectories, we get a new policy and that's it. Okay. And an open question in that batch reinforcement learning setting is what are the conditions of the batch data so that we can obtain an optimal policy this way. So what needs to be present in the replay buffer so that by just applying this approach, you can get an optimal policy. And if this particular condition that we don't know, that's a question of current research, if this condition does not hold, can we still do better than doing this? And the answer is yes, we can. Okay. The idea is that we can do more than one iteration and just iterate what I have presented to you in the previous slide more than once. So the idea is that the advantage weighted regression, this is exactly what it does. It performs a weighted regression from an initial policy, which is generally random. Okay. So it will get a policy which will be better than the random samples it has observed. From that particular policy plus some exploration, it generates new data. And it iterates again from this new data. So it might get a second policy which is better than the previous one. And it will generate new data from this better policy plus some exploration, and so on and so on. And little by little, the policy should improve to something very efficient. So that's the the non-technical presentation of the advantage weighted regression algorithm. Now I will move to the more technical presentation. Okay, so first let me say that I'm referring to that particular version of the paper which is currently available on archive. The second thing that I should say is that I will present to you the algorithm, but this presentation is a little different from the one that you find in the paper. I made the choice of a small change. The idea is that in the paper, the algorithm takes as input a first policy and will generate a random trajectories into the replay buffer before starting the improvement loop, whereas I made the choice to start from a buffer of trajectories, which can be either a random replay buffer generated by random trajectories, or expert demonstration, or anything that can have some value. So I assume that this framework is a little more general than the one provided in the paper. And so it takes this replay buffer of trajectories as input, and the output will be the policy after k-max iterations. So the algorithm does the following. It will perform some iterations from 1 to k-max, and for each iteration, it does two things. First, it approximates the value function at the current iteration, and then the policy at the current iteration too. So to approximate the value function, it will try to determine the expectation of the difference between the return over the batch of trajectories minus some value function, and it is looking for the value function that minimizes the expectation of this difference. So it looks for the value function that best reproduces the return values here. Okay. So that's standard regression over the return of trajectories using least square criterion. And then to approximate the policy, it's also looking for an expectation, but that's the expectation of the log of the policy times some return value, and this return value is the exponential of the return minus the baseline, and this baseline is the value function, divided by a temperature parameter that we call beta. Okay, so that's very similar to policy gradient techniques. in policy gradient techniques, we are also looking for the max over policies of the log probability of the policy times of return, but this here what is new is using this exponentiation as the and this temperature parameter. And from that policy, you will generate a new buffer data with trajectories obtained by that particular policy, and you loop again and again. Okay. Okay. And if we just do one iteration of the loop, this will be batch reinforcement learning, and that corresponds to an algorithm that I will mention later on, which is called Marwahl. So more precisely, how do we estimate the value function, so the critique, let's say, or the baseline? As I said, we are minimizing the expectation. We are looking for the value function which minimizes the expectation of the difference between the observed return and that particular critique. Okay, and to do this, since we cannot minimize over an expectation, because obtaining the expectation would correspond to performing an infinity of trajectories, we just minimize the expectation over a batch. So we have a batch of m trajectories, and we perform that particular calculation. And rather than using pure Monte Carlo, which would be a possibility to get that particular calculation, it's used the advantage weighted regression algorithm is using some TD of lambda estimate with using the previous estimate of the value function as bootstrap. Okay, so it estimates with some lambda return rather than pure Monte Carlo, and using bootstrap it's a little more efficient, but also using bootstrap it becomes a little biased and is not as off policy as it might be if it was using Monte Carlo. And in the paper, they give the value of lambda as 0.95. Okay. For estimating the policy, as I said, this is this way. This is very similar to policy gradient techniques. Again, we approximate the expectation over a batch of m trajectories. Okay. And in the derivation that I won't explain in details, they show you that using this particular criterion can result in enforcing a trust region. So that's related to trust region policy optimization or relative entropy policy search algorithms, which do this kind of things. And I refer to you to the corresponding videos if you want to know more. Okay. And one point, one technical detail, is that the weights corresponding to these terms are clipped, okay, because they may run to very large or very low value, okay, so they clip this so that the value is never higher than W max is 20, okay. Let's say also that in other papers, there are some explanations. Okay, from in a paper from Peters and Chal, which is referenced here, they give you a way to compute the best value, the best possible value for beta. But in the advantage weighted regression paper, they just take a fixed beta of 0.05. Okay, and they don't study what would change if they would get beta from the way it is explained here. So this algorithm is related to a few papers. Okay, so the first, which is based on the same idea, that was reward weighted regression instead of advantage weighted regression. So that's the same idea, but using reward weighted instead of advantage weighting. And this was not using deep network, because that's a rather old paper, so that's 2007. Okay. And there is also the lower paper, which is closer because it's also using advantage weighted regression, but not based on deep neural network, and that's NIPS 2009 paper. So those two algorithms are very close to the idea. Okay, and those two are also very close to the idea, but they are more set into an imitation learning setting. So Marwhile is just performing one iteration of AWR, but that's the same equation as AWR. So in the case of batch reinforcement learning, okay, and self-limitation learning is very, very similar to AWR2, but instead of using something which is very close to policy gradient, they combine the A2C algorithm plus the criterion of AWR. And they also show that there is some link with soft Q-learning, which is one ancestor of the soft actor critique algorithm. Now let's have a look at the experimental study that they perform in the paper, as we would do in a journal club, for instance. So what they do in the experimental setup is the following. First, they have a batch size of 2,000 samples per iteration, while their replay buffer contains the 50,000 most recent samples. So it means that the replay buffer contains samples from the 25 previous iterations or from the 25 previous policies. So it's partly of policy in the sense that it's not using samples just from the previous policies, but from quite older policies. Besides, so as to perform learning, they use stochastic gradient descent with a momentum of 0.9, and they take a mini batch size for stochastic gradient descent of the, this value. Okay, the learning rate of the policy and value function are respectively those. Okay, and the value function is updated with 2,000 gradient steps per iteration, whereas the policy is updated with 1,000 gradient steps per iteration. So what does this mean? In fact, you are performing regression, and regression is a kind of can be performed in a stochastic gradient descent way, and they just take a fixed number of states, okay, and they do not study at all the sensitivity of the quality of the regression corresponding to the number of steps of gradient descent steps that they performed, okay, whereas in most papers where you study regression, you would take a validation set and stop performing this iteration when you start to overfit. Okay, so here probably the technique could be improved a little bit. Now let's have a look at the results they get. So first of all, as usual in those deep reinforcement learning papers, they show the performance of their algorithm, which is the red curve here with respect to many competitors. And interestingly, they show that their technique is not always the best. For instance, on AlphaCheetah, they are defeated by DDPG or TD3. Okay, no, DDPG in that case. And in Walker 2D, they are defeated by SAC. Okay, but they say that their performance is more consistent over benchmarks than competing methods. Okay, by the way, you can see that sometimes SAC is better than DDPG, and sometimes that's the contrary. Another point is that they study the imitation performance of the algorithm, so they fill the replay buffer with expert demonstration corresponding to complicated motions from humans and dog-like mannequins. Okay, and they show that using their technique, the imitation performance raises faster than using different techniques. And you can find nice videos of these experiments here. Okay. Then they study the sensitivity to some of the hyperparameters, but not all. In particular, they show that using some clipping on the weights is absolutely crucial so as to get nice results. As you can see here, with clipping you get these results, and without clipping you get something which is much worse. Okay, and that's interesting because using the clipping means that you don't follow exactly the exponentiating of the advantage term as I explained to you in the previous part. Okay, so this raises doubts on the validity of doing some exponentiating the way they do so. Okay, and they don't study the sensitivity to the lambda of TD lambda and to the beta, which is the temperature parameter. Okay, By the way, they perform an ablation study where they remove some of the components of the algorithm, and they show different things. So first, they remove advantage weighting and replace it with reward weighting, and they show that their algorithm is consistently better than RWR. Okay, here you can see that the red is theirs and the violet one is RWR, and RWR always performs, apart from that particular experiment, it performs worse than theirs. Okay, so using advantage versus reward appears critical. Then they remove the baseline, okay, and they show that using this baseline is important because when they have no baseline, you have the orange curve, which is very, here it is better, but in general it is worse, okay. They also show that using data from the 25 previous policies is better than just using just the previous policy data, which would correspond to doing on-policy learning, okay. And finally, they see no major impact of using TD of lambda instead of Monte Carlo in Walker 2D, okay. Whereas it has a large impact of Alchita. So using TD lambda, is it good or not? That depends on the environment. This is also one reason why studying the sensitivity of lambda does not matter much, because there are cases where TD of lambda will perform much better and times where Monte Carlo is much better. Honestly, if I was the author, I would have used Monte Carlo because I would have some algorithm that would be more of policy than by using TD of lambda. Anyways, so the properties of the algorithms are the following. First, the return is estimated with bootstrap, with TD lambda, whereas the value function is estimated with regression, but it's not still a bootstrap method because this is just to estimate the baseline that you need some bootstrap. Okay, so if it's not a bootstrap method, this algorithm is safe with respect to the deadly triad issue, which appears when you get function approximation, off-policy learning, and bootstrap. Okay, so here you are off-policy, you have function approximation, but you don't use bootstrap really, you rather use Monte Carlo methods, so you are safe with respect to that. But anyways, this is still more sample efficient than other Monte Carlo techniques like TRPO or PPO. In principle, as I just said, AWR could be truly off-policy if it was just using Monte Carlo techniques, but in the derivation, they show that the current policy should not be too distant from the previous one if you want to have some trust region phenomenon. So if you have this trust region phenomenon, you are dependent indirectly on the previous policy because you don't want to be too far from it, so you are still quite on-policy. So AWR cannot be said truly off-policy. By the way, the derivation is quite similar to the standard policy gradient derivation, but it's derived from an expectation maximization approach. So if you are more mathematically oriented, and if you have watched my policy gradient video explaining the derivation, I encourage you to have a look at that particular derivation, which is interesting. Finally, what's the difference to the standard policy gradient techniques? If you look at the policy gradient criterion, you have something like that. So you take the log derivative of the probability of action given by your policy times some advantage term, which is this way, okay. And in the advantage weighted regression algorithm, you have this particular criterion, and two things are different. First, instead of taking the probability of the previous state corresponding to the previous policy and taking the action corresponding to the previous policy, here you take these coming from some replay buffer. So in that respect, you have much more off policy. You don't need the samples to come from the previous policy. And the other point is that instead of taking that particular advantage value as a return, you take the exponentiation of that advantage value divided by a temperature parameter beta, which allows you to rather tune this particular part of the algorithm. Okay. And finally, to say this more intuitively, in policy gradient, from the data we compute a gradient related to and applied to the current policy, whereas in advantage weighted regression, from the data we compute a completely new policy, okay, which it's computed from regression and not from bootstrap to the current policy. Finally, a point that I want to stress is that the authors consider that using exponentiation in the return enforces a trust region, and in policy gradient, a negative step size can make learning very unstable. And for instance, in the CACLA algorithm, you can see that they just take step size when the return is positive. Okay. So by exponentiating as they do, you guarantee that you always get the step size positive. Okay. So in principle, policy gradient with exponentiated step size should work better than not exponentiating. Okay. But first, we have seen that they need to enforce some clipping on that exponentiation, which is an issue. And the other thing is that if we want to check that policy gradient works better with exponentiation, we should definitely check it with a negative reward problem, which is not what they do in the paper. And that's it for today. Don't hesitate to send me questions at this email address. Bye bye.